Hello, viewer. You rejoin me on my heroic journey, or my fool's errand, to develop a face mask with more visibility. Throughout this journey, I've battled what I call clamshelling. You see, my face mask is made of a net and a frame. And when a puck hits the net pulls on the frame, which flexes in a clamshell-like motion. This slackens the net and allows the puck to get closer to the player's face. This is not good. In previous attempts to unclamshell my cage, I've blindly added stiffness to the frame and hoped for the best. This time, I wanted to take a more targeted approach. I wanted to figure out how stiff the frame really needs to be. And to answer that, I had to answer another question. How hard is the net pulling on the frame? There are a million ways to answer this question, but mine was to design an experiment. The rough idea, as seen in this early sketch, was to mount a net and two force sensors, or load cells, between two bars. Ball hits net, net pulls on bars, bars push on load cells reveal how much force they experienced. Pretty simple. Of course, things got slightly more complicated as I fleshed out concepts to connect components in the real world. But as I looked into load cells, I ran into a problem. The only affordable option I found collected 80 data points per second. The impact between a puck and a face mask only takes a fraction of a second. With 80 samples per second, I'd likely miss the highest force. Ideally, I'd find a system with more samples per second to improve my chances of capturing the peak. Unfortunately, these systems cost far too much. So if nothing suited my needs right off the shelf, what other options did I have? After about a furious Googling, I found something called a peak detector circuit. Allegedly, this would store the highest value recorded by the load cell. Ideal, except for the fact that I'm hopeless when it comes to electronics and wouldn't trust myself to wire a light bulb to a potato. So it was back to the sketchpad to find a purely mechanical solution. The answer came to me in the form of springs. The force on a spring is the spring constant times the distance the spring is stretched. The force is what we're trying to determine. The spring constant is given by the manufacturer, and the distance the spring is stretched could be plotted with a marker, like a seismograph. After I'd basked in my genius for a minute, I realized that this too had a fatal flaw. By adding springs, I'd be changing the very thing I was trying to measure. The springs would soften the impact. It'd be like trying to figure out how much it hurt to punch a brick wall by punching a pillow. Another bout of furious Googling later, and I found salvation in the form of a load cell system which collects 1,200 samples per second for a very reasonable price. On top of this, it's made for Stone Age engineers like myself, by a Canadian company. So it should have an innate knowledge of hockey and a familiarity with being owned by Americans. To get all 1,200 of those samples, I could only use one load cell instead of the two I'd initially intended. With this constraint and more like it, the test rig began to take shape almost on its own. Its bones were 2x4s because I needed stiffness for cheap, and I wanted to work with a soft, fragrant material. Rails constrained the motion of the net in every direction but one, so that the load cell wouldn't get distracted. The entire test rig had to be a certain height, so it would align with my pitching machine. Every component had to be assembled in a very particular order, so it would look good in a stop-motion sequence. And there you have it. As you saw, everything went together extremely smoothly, and there were definitely no remade parts. Anyways, let me show you around. Up top you have the single load cell, which plugs into an interface device, and into the computer, where data appears. This was all surprisingly straightforward and easy to set up. There's a button for calibration, and you just hang a known weight to confirm everything is working as it should. Instead of the load cell up top, I can also swap in springs. Through this middle hole, I can slip in a Sharpie, and have that purely mechanical tester I'd imagined before. This was a backup in case I couldn't get the load cell to work, but conveniently, it illustrates how everything works. When I shoot a ball from the pitching machine, the ball hits the net, and the net pulls down on the rail-mounted 2x4s. Those in turn pull on the springs, stretching them, while drawing a Sharpie line on the paper. I can then measure that Sharpie line to determine the force. This is the same principle behind the load cell, except on a much, much smaller scale. The net pulls down on the 2x4s, which pull on the load cell. It stretches microscopically, and through electronic wizardry, notes down the length of its own Sharpie line, so to speak, 1,000 times per second. Pretty magical. So when you shoot a ball at the net, you get a plot that looks like this, which shows that at 25 miles per hour, the net pulls with a peak of 650 pounds of force, at 45, 1,000 pounds, and at 65 miles per hour, 1,500 pounds. Of course, this is the absolute worst case scenario, with no help from horizontal ropes. But I am a little intimidated by that number nevertheless. Luckily, dealing with it, or reducing it, is a problem for future me. Thanks for watching.